So today I would like to report our attempts to investigate the mechanism of prion toxicity using antibodies. And this was mostly the work of an MD PhD student, now postdoc, Karl Fronczek. And essentially, we have been using antibodies for more than 20 years to try and elucidate the function of the prion protein and also to develop therapeutics against prions. And essentially what we know is that the prion protein sits on the surface of the cells. It's anchored with a glycolipid anchor, and it contains an amino terminus. And what we know is that there is a proteolysis event that liberates amino terminus, and the amino terminus will induce a myelinotropic function. However, when the prions attach to the, so the pathological prions attach to normal prion protein, then a neurotoxic signal can be transmitted. Now, in an experiment that we did 25 years ago by Sebastian Brandner, who was my first postdoc when I first started in Zurich, essentially what we did was to introduce a graft of cells overexpressing the prion protein into a PRP knockout mouse. And here we discovered that when we infected these pseudochimeric mice with prions, prion pathology, which is visible by this vacuolation, was extending within the graft, but it did not extend beyond the graft. And this indicated that the prions, which were moving freely actually in this region, that the prions were necessitate the normal prion protein on the surface of the neurons in order to rate their damage. So in a way, this means that the prion protein is not only the substrate for conversion of prions, but also is required for transducing the toxicity of prions. Now, another thing that we did, since we were interested in developing therapy, was to try passive immunotherapy against prions. And this never worked. But then eventually what we did was to make by brute force, essentially a transgenic mouse, and this was a work from exactly 20 years ago, which would express an anti-prion heavy chain in its germline. And these mice were actually protected against prions. So this was actually the first proof of principle, actually, that you could treat any kind of neurodegenerative disease using antibodies. Now, that was obviously very exciting. And of course, now there is a lot of antibodies against Alzheimer's and against Parkinson's and frontotemporal dementia, and many other things. But this, in reality, we continue to work on the prion protein, but then we actually found, very much to our horror, that some of these anti-prion antibodies are extremely neurotoxic. And this is an example of an antibody called POM1. And this POM1 antibody was now delivered onto slices, organotypic chronic slices of cerebellum. And what we see is that by delivering POM1 antibody, you see that these are transverse sections of the cerebellum. And this is the thickness of the cerebellar slice. You see, this is the plane of sectioning. And what you see is that after 3 days of treatment with this antibody, essentially the cerebellar slices sinters together and the neurons are all gone. So these are the Purkinje cells and these are the cerebellar granule neurons, and they all disappear if you give this POM1 antibody. So this is super toxic antibody. And this is totally complement independent. You can also reproduce it using FAB1 fragments and even using a single chain FV recombinant fragments. So it's a property and a consequence of the binding of this POM1 antibody to the prion protein. Now, but how does this work? I was super excited and interested in understanding how this works because my thinking was that this may actually mimic the process by which the pathological prion protein damages the brain. And there is a lot of reasons to believe that this is correct, including the fact that most substances that prevent the toxicity of the bona fide prion also prevent the toxicity of the POM1 antibody. So first idea was, well, maybe the antibody is unfolding the normal prion protein. protein. So we performed a crystallographic analysis together with Michael James in Edmonton, and this is the structure, the crystal structure of the FAB1 fragment of the POM1 of the toxic antibody bound to the normal prion protein. And the big disappointment there was that it does not unfold the prion protein. In fact, I couldn't see anything that happened to the prion protein as a result of the binding. And then I had the good fortune that I met Luca Varani, who is at the Istituto di Ricerca Biomedica in Bellinzona. And what Luca did, he was telling me, well, you know, the crystal structure won't tell you the whole thing because these molecules are dynamic. They move over time. And maybe if we did some molecular dynamic simulations, we might see things that are actually invisible in the crystal structure. And in order to test whether this was the case, Luca Varani performed several molecular dynamic studies, and what he saw is actually that there are two conformers of the normal prion protein, and the most frequent one is this one. Here you have the alpha-2 and the alpha-3 helices of the prion protein, and they're very far apart, and they actually don't touch each other because the distance between this arginine and this histidine is pretty long, it's 5.3 angstrom, and therefore these residues do not interact. When the POM1 antibody comes in, and this is the structure, what you see now here is the POM1, the toxic antibody. When it comes in, the prediction from Luca was that a second form becomes much more populated, and this form, a hydrogen bond is actually built between the histidine at 140 and the arginine at 208. Now this leads, we call this the H-latch. It's a hydrogen latch that essentially changes the conformation of the prion protein in that it blocks this loop, which is very flexible here, and it becomes completely rigid here. So and this is essentially what you see here. These are rigidity plots. And what you see is that this is the normal form of the prion protein. And when the antibody comes in, this portion here becomes more rigid, and as a consequence, another portion of the prion protein becomes much more flexible. So you have compensatory flexibility of other regions of the prion protein. This region also becomes more flexible. This is the hinge to the N-terminus. Now, and the calculation from the molecular dynamics indicate that the H-latch in the normal prion protein occurs only in less than 20% of the time of the simulation time. However, as soon as you put in POM1, then now you have more than 90% of the isoform is populated by the hydrogen latched form. So the idea was, okay, maybe we can mutagenize. If all of this is true, if the hydrogen latch is really what creates the toxicity, maybe we can mutagenize the antibody in such a way that it will still bind, but will no longer form the H-latch. So the idea was, again, if you see here, there is a whole network of interactions between the residues of the antibodies and the residues of the prion protein. And the idea is, okay, maybe you can put an alanine scan and actually mutagenize all these residues until you find something that will no longer be able to create the H-latch. And this was done, and these are the results from the molecular dynamic simulation. So this is all theoretical computing work. And we find that, for example, this variant here, where the tyrosine at position 104 of the heavy chain of the antibody is substituted with an alanine, essentially completely abrogates the formation of the hydrogen latch. So then all these molecules are actually synthesized by Luca Varani, and Carl Frontzek then measured the affinity for the target. And as it turns out, here the affinity is measured by surface plasma resonance, and here the affinity is measured by FRET. And they largely overlap. And what you can see is that some of these mutants in the heavy chain or in the light chain completely lose their affinity. This is a terrible affinity. You can't use these antibodies. However, some of the antibodies still retain essentially the entire affinity of the wild type antibody, and including the one why the tyrosine 104A in the heavy chain substitution. Now, this is very interesting. So this molecule is essentially an antibody that binds exactly like POM1, but does not induce the hydrogen latch. So what happens when you give it to brain slices? So again, this is our beloved paradigm of organotypic slice cultures. And what you see is that if you, this is the arbor vitae of the cerebellum, is the beautiful cerebellar granule layer that you can see in the slices. And if you give POM1, it completely disappears. It's destroyed. The slice, this is the toxic antibody. Now, these slices are from TGA20 transgenic mice. These are mice that overexpress embryon protein. They are hypersensitive to prions. Now, however, if you give the substitute, the POM1 antibody, which again has very high affinity, but it's no longer toxic. So it's so POM1 is toxic, but POM1 substituted with 104H, 104A is no longer toxic. Now that is perhaps not so exciting, but what really became exciting was when we found that this antibody mutant is actually an anti-prion antibody. It protects against the prions. So again, what you see here we have the TG20 brain slices. We treat them with non-infectious brain homogenate, and you, as expected, nothing happens. You have a beautiful slice, and so it's a negative control. If you infect them with prions, and these are the Rocky Mountain Laboratory strain of prions, the prions within 5 weeks completely destroy the slice. However, if you treat the slice, the infected slice, and treat them now with a substituted POM1 antibody, now you can protect them. So the antibody in blocks the neurodegeneration induced by prions. Now, and before you tell me that this is an artifact of the TG20 overexpressing mice, I can tell you that we repeated the experiment with slices from wild-type mice, and these are BLEX6 slices. And again, this is the negative control, normal brain homogenate. So non-infected, you see brain prion infection destroys these slices, but this is non-infectious brain homogenate with the antibody, and again the slice is very nice. But if you infect the slice and give the mutated antibody, then again you protect the slice. So this is, I think, huge, because essentially what I'm showing you is that a point mutation that was designed by rational considerations is capable of transforming a toxic anti-prion antibody into a protected anti-prion antibody. Now the question is, how does this work? So what I told you is that our interpretation is really that the H latch, the hydrogen latch, is what drives toxicity. How could we test this? Well, our idea was maybe we can make a mutant of the prion protein in which we do two cysteine substitutions in this part of the protein that will essentially mimic the H-latch that is induced by POM1. So we make essentially a prion protein that spontaneously adopts the conformation of the prion protein bound to the POM1 toxic antibody. And this was put into an AAV vector. And what you can see is that if you give, if you express with the same AAV just the wild type prion protein, then you see a beautiful level of expression here in the cerebellum. And it stays on after the 15 days. And this is 31 days. If you do the same with the two cysteine mutant, what you see is that you have nice expression at 15 days, but at 31 days, everything is gone. So again, and now you could ask, is it gone because the expression is lost, or is it gone because the cells are lost? Well, it is gone because the cells are lost, because here, Here we are looking at calbinding, and this is an endogenous marker. And what you see here, beautiful calbinding expressing cells. Now you infect with you transduce the normal wild-type prion protein and nothing happens. After 13-1 days, you still have the beautiful calbinding expressing cells. But if you express the tocystein mutant, you see that you are now wiping out the calbinding expressing cells. So the expression of the tocystein mutant is intrinsically toxic. Now, this is nice, but it does not really prove that the HLAS is really what drives the toxicity. So we thought the following. As Luca has shown by NMR spectroscopy, there are two conformers of PRP that are differentially populated, the one with the HLAS and the one where the two parts of the protein are not bound to each other. Now, we thought, okay, let's now make a screen, a phage screen, and identify phage antibodies that preferentially bind to the recombinant wild-type PRP, but do not bind to the tocystein mutant. And the idea was that these antibodies will bind to the normal prion protein and prevent it from flipping into the HLAS conformation. Now, if the HLAS conformation is really what is toxic, then these antibodies should be protective. So here I show you the results from three different FAB fragments cloned from a phage library. And for example, FABA10 is vastly preferring the binding to the normal prion protein over the tocystein mutant. Same thing with D9, whereas E2 essentially bind to the same extent, the recombinant prion protein and the tocystein. Now, let's see what happens if you give each one of these antibodies to the slices expressing the prion protein and infected with prions. And what you see is that, again, here, the negative control, you give the non-infected brain homogenates, you have a beautiful expression of the normal prion protein, you give the prions to them, you infect the slices, and you see that the new N stain disappears, the slice is being destroyed. You give, however, in the presence of the FABA10, you prevent the destruction of the slice. Same thing with D9, whereas the E2, which does not really discriminate, does not prevent toxicity. So at this point, we think that the plot thickens considerably, and we are now pretty convinced that the HLAS is really what is driving the toxicity of prions. And another day, I will tell you how this really happens, what are the downstream events, and we have already a pretty clear idea of what happens there. Let me just tell you that because the FAB10 antibody was very interesting, we then mapped its epitope by NMR. And what we can see here is this is the FAB10 complex to the prion protein. And when you map the surface of the prion protein that touches the FAB10, now these are the two cysteines. This is essentially where the HLAS occurs. And what you can see here is this is the binding site of POM1, and this is the binding site of FAB10, and you see they are completely different, and yet they are both neuroprotective, which is for me very important because it obviously indicates that we are not simply talking about steric hindrance. And finally, I would like to acknowledge and thank all the people who have done all this work, and particularly Carl Fronzek, who has spent now several years on this and has really made an amazing piece of work together with Marco Bardelli in the group of Luca Varani in Bellinzona, and also with help from Georg Meisel and Thomas Knowles at the University of Cambridge. Many thanks.